Hi, I'm Dr. John Douillard, and I want to welcome you to our podcast. We're having an amazing discussion tonight with Dr. Bob Quinn, organic farmer, one of the original farmers of ancient wheat. I want to talk to you about that. As you all know, I wrote a book called Eat Wheat, and we've been doing a lot of talking about how to navigate around toxic wheat, processed foods in general, and the benefits of that. And I am so delighted to have Dr. Bob Quinn here today with us. I think you're going to be really excited to hear directly from an organic farmer. And Dr. Bob Quinn is an organic farmer of 30 years, a progressive leader in promoting organic and sustainable agriculture throughout his home state, the nation, and the rest of the world. In 1986, Dr. Quinn's company, Montana Flour and Grains, introduced the natural food industry an ancient wheat called khorasan. It was marketed under the trademark KAMUT, which Quinn's family registered. That's their register, with their trademark. KAMUT is him. So this is the KAMUT organic farmer who brought this to us. So how cool is that? How exciting is that to have him talk to us? Quinn's been involved in many organizations over the years, including Big Sandy Rotary Club, Montana Farm Bureau, Montana Grain Growers, Montana Organic Association, the Organic Trade Association, International Federation of Organic Agricultural Movements. Bottom line is, you know, Dr. Bob probably has been maybe one of the earliest organic farmers in Montana, clearly one of the first ancient wheat farmers that, and he's still growing today. So he was way ahead of the curve. We actually got our start sort of at the same time back in 1986. We were sort of trying to figure out what we're gonna do with our life, right?
That's right.
anyway, welcome, Dr. Bob. So great
to have you here.
Thank you. I would love to hear initially how you got started. I mean, ancient wheat in 1986, I mean, organic wheat in 1986 was sort of crazy. Tell me how it all started.
Well, actually, it goes back to when I was in high school. So about in 1963, I was about a junior in high school, went to a county fair, and this old man, probably younger than I am now, was passing out this giant wheat in a coffee can. And he called me over and says, "Hey, sonny," he says, "you want to see some old King Tut's wheat?" And I said, "Well, sure." So I walked over and he put a handful in my hand, and it was a giant wheat. It was about three times the size of regular wheat. And the story went that a fellow from our county in Montana had been in Portugal, went to the bar one night, and a fellow airman, he was in the Air Force, said he had come back from Egypt and taken this grain out of a tomb in Egypt.
You kidding?
That's what he said. And so he gave him 30 or 40 kernels. He sent it home to his dad, who started growing it in Montana. North central Montana's wheat country, so he's very familiar with that. And it grew, and it was a giant wheat. It was very tall. This is what it looks like. It's kind of beat up from my airplane travel, but I carry some in my hat.
You see that?
So I can show people.
This is from King Tut's tomb.
Well, that's what we were told.
It's granddad's. Granddaddy was
King Tut. That's what we were told. So.
How cool is that?
It was a great novelty, and everybody loved the story, but they didn't have anything to do with, know what to do with it.
Yeah.
So it just sort of disappeared after a while. I was attending graduate school at UC Davis about 14 years later. So in 77, I was eating a package of corn nuts one afternoon, and I got idly looking at the back of the package, and it said, "Corn nuts made with a giant corn." And I thought, wow, I wonder if they'd be interested in a giant wheat. So I called up Corn Nuts, and they were just in Oakland at that time, an independent company, not far away from where I was. And they said, "Oh, we might be interested in that." And I called my dad up right away, and I said, "Dad, see if you can find some of that old King Tut's wheat." And he called me back in about a week, and he said, "Well, I found a little jar, about a pint, half full." And I said, "Well, send me a few spoonfuls," and I sent it to Corn Nuts. And a week later or so, they called back, or I called them, check up on it. And they said, "This is fantastic. This makes a fantastic snack. We'll take 10,000 pounds. And I said, "Oh, well, we don't have 10,000 pounds. In fact, I don't even have 2 pounds. I said, "But if you'll wait a few years, I'll plant it and grow it." And we sent it to California and grew it over the winter, and we grew it at our place in the summer. And in about 3 years, we had 50 pounds from our little handful. And I called up the corn nuts people, and I said, "Okay, we got 50 pounds. We're ready to seed a half acre of this stuff." And the guy I talked to was gone. No one even remembered the project. They weren't interested anymore. So we just put it on the shelf, and there it sat. And then in 86, the year you're mentioning, I had by this time started a small flour mill to try to sell our our wheat directly to whole grain bakers in California from northern Montana. I'd come back to the ranch in 78 after deciding I didn't really want to continue in academia. And we went to a food show. My dad decided to take this little jar of the ancient wheat, and he showed it to everybody that walked by. Thousands of people walked by our booth. And my cousin and I, who had started our wheat and flour milling business, had our pockets full of referrals by the end of the three-day show. My dad had one referral. We both thought we'd done well. So we went home and we started the milling, and I helped my dad and he helped me. We got the half acre, the bushel, nearly a bushel, out of the shed, planted a half acre. That was 31 years ago. We started 1 half acre, and this next year we will be planting, or this year, coming year, probably looking at 120,000 or acres from Montana, Alberta, and Saskatchewan, all organic.
Really? And it all KAMUT?
Yep, all sold under the trademark of KAMUT.
Wow. So when you talk about wheat, you know, back then, you mentioned you sold it to the whole grain industry.
Yes.
Can you tell us the difference between whole grain, refined grain? What happens to wheat in this processing process? Can you take us through that whole step?
Best I can. Yeah. There's actually several steps that have gone on, and as you very well know, that the seed itself has been changed greatly to primarily to please the industrialization of our food. In this country, we've had one main goal, and that's cheap food. Yeah. And now we're starting to understand that this cheap food is coming to us at a very high cost. And it's a cost we don't pay at the checkout counter. It's a cost we pay later in how we feel and our diseases and chronic things that are happening to us. That's what's happening. But because of that drive to make cheap food, everybody wanted higher yields. So the farmers wanted higher yields, so they made wheat that was shorter, more disease resistant, more able to respond to chemical applications and make much higher yields. The millers wanted higher yields, so they made wheat that was had higher brand, so it was easier to flake off, so you had more white flour, so they had higher yields. The bakers, they wanted higher yields. They wanted to be able to make more loaves of bread with less pounds of wheat. And they were able to do that by changing the starch and the protein, probably more importantly the protein, to make very elastic complex, which would hold the gas.
A lot of the science is debatable on whether the protein levels have actually increased in the wheat over the years. Are you saying that the gluten content has increased?
Not really too much,
yeah.
But the quality has changed tremendously.
And what do you mean by quality?
Well, I mean the type of protein that's there. There's many different types of protein. This grain that we're growing is a very close relative to durum. Durum is a pasta wheat.
Right.
The protein in that is much different than bread wheat,
right,
which is designed to make, and it has been bred to make the wonderful air bread that Americans have gotten used to over the years. And so they wanted bread that would rise, and they made the dough so elastic and so almost it had the resiliency of a rubber balloon.
Right.
That the little cells became so strong with the protein that was in this dough that they could hold so much gas that you could rise up a loaf of bread filled with air and get many loaves of bread out of the same bucket of wheat.
So you're basically eating air.
Well, more.
Yeah, more air than...
They're selling air for wheat for bread prices.
Right.
That was what's happening with the traditional American white bread.
Right. So the different kinds of flour that they used were for that, but there were definitely, you know, that was for bread making and for pastry making they would use. And there was always a little bit more gluten in that pastry flour than there was in, I guess, Wonder Bread flour or sort of pastry flour, right?
But well, if you're talking about cookies and whatnot, they want actually low protein in that because they don't want it to stick together.
Okay.
They want the cookie to go flat. And if you have a very high protein wheat, if you make a cookie out of it, just going to say it's a glob. It holds together.
Right.
But with low protein, it spreads out because it's not enough to holding it together.
So when they started, you know, kind of changing the wheat and kind of hybridizing the wheat to meet our demands, the protein content didn't really change, but you're saying the kind of protein changed. Is
yes,
that right?
Yes, the quality.
Because I always thought it was the amount of gluten changed whether it would rise or be able to withstand kind of that aeration kind of bread. but I didn't realize it was the actual kind of protein.
It's the kind. The KAMUT khorasan wheat that we're dealing with actually has much higher protein than normal wheat.
Right, I've heard twice as much.
Well, twice as much as certain amino acids and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
But probably 20% more if you're looking at the difference between 14 and 16%.
Right.
The total protein in whole
right.
grain.
Right.
So it's always 2% higher in our farm growing side by side, just as a general rule. So it's higher, but at the same time, people who cannot eat modern wheat can eat this without difficulty at all. So it's not a quantity thing, it's a quality thing.
I read a study that I wrote about in my book, and it was comparing KAMUT with certain varieties of modern wheat, and there's so many different varieties, thousands of varieties
yes.
of wheat that you just can't go. You know, we say modern versus ancient, you're talking about thousands of different kinds
yes.
of modern, thousands of different kinds of ancient
yes.
wheat. But one study showed that the KAMUT had twice as much of the gluten, but it had twice the reduction of inflammation, and it actually lowered blood sugar and
mm-hmm.
lowered the cholesterol level significantly. So here's a study that showed that the gluten, the bread, or the grain, with the most gluten, actually had the most beneficial effects.
Mm-hmm.
So it helped me understand what, you know, KAMUT's got more gluten, more protein. The thing, we have a $16 billion a year gluten-free industry. People
yeah.
are eating processed bread because gluten's the new poison. But how can you help me understand how the bread or the grain with the most gluten is actually the best?
Well, again, it's all a question of quality.
Yeah.
The ancient and even the heritage and heirloom wheats have been changed so dramatically, as I mentioned earlier, just to make a bigger loaf of bread. And the protein is what they mostly have changed. They've also changed the starch. So it's a charged protein complex that makes the dough resilient and rise better. But because the protein has been changed, now it's bigger. The protein is bigger. I mean, not the number of grams or more per loaf, but the individual molecules are generally bigger.
Right.
And they're harder to digest because the body now is seeing something that they have not seen traditionally before.
Right.
And it's bigger, more complex. It just takes longer to digest it. And some people who are on the edge of sensitivities then are triggered by that, and they have a lot of trouble with that.
Mm-hmm.
They have bloating,
right.
they have cramps, they get eczema, all kinds of things that are maybe not, they're not bedridden, but some
right.
are,
right.
but mostly they're just small things that they can tell that something is not right.
Talk to me about the difference between, because there are studies that show that the pesticides that we spray on foods
yes.
can
yes.
kill the microbes that make the enzymes that are specifically engineered to digest the gluten or the gliadins in wheat. So talk to me about the impact of the non-organic, you know, conventional grain versus the organic grain that you grow.
Well, there's been some studies out of Canada, which is finding that the effect of glyphosate, which is Roundup, which
right.
is very widely used, and we're finding it is so contaminating of the environment, we're finding it actually in the rainfall now. It's falling on our land. We have glyphosate falling out of the
right.
sky in the rain. In micro amounts, but measurable amounts. So that, for some people, causes...
Everything has glyphosate on it.
Almost everything, yes. Almost everything.
Okay, so I need to... I have a lot to ask you.
I didn't mean to open up that camera,
no,
but
no,
it's
no,
true.
It's
we need
really
to talk about it.
No,
we need to talk about it.
People need to know.
Yeah.
Because we need to know, like, there's this whole thing of, the you know, using the glyphosate as a desiccant to increase the harvest and the yield
mm-hmm.
at the end. At the end of... The growing season, you spray glyphosate on it, and it accelerates the maturation of the wheat.
No, it kills it. It dries it out.
It kills it out and dries it.
Mm-hmm.
Then you can harvest it, right?
Yeah.
Is that how rare, how frequent is that happening now?
Well, the further north you go, the more it happens because people are anxious to get their wheat harvested before it starts to snow.
We're talking about Canada?
Yeah, I'm talking about Canada mostly.
Yeah.
And even in Montana, Dakotas, it's not unheard of, but it's unusual because we're normally harvesting in August.
Oh, really? Yeah.
But if we get delayed by rains, I mean, you know, we're talking about climate change, what that's doing to us.
Yeah.
I mean, we got more rain last year than we've gotten in 20 years. It was a very wet year for us. It delayed the harvest.
Yeah.
It put some of the people in our area did not harvest until December. Their last fields, and they had to wait till the fields were frozen before they could go in with their combines and harvest.
You're telling me that based on how quickly and when you can harvest, that the use of the glyphosate is as a desiccant, right, is what they call it?
Right. It's a desiccant. It kills the plants
right.
on contact.
Right. So
all
is
plants.
That still happening as needed?
Yes. And yes. And the further north you go, where it's more and more common for the harvest to be occurring now in September and even into beginning of October, well, as you go into Alberta and Saskatchewan, you can start to have snow in October, and you don't want really heavy snow on your grain.
This is only non-organic farms, right?
Yes.
Right.
But they're right next door to organic ones.
Right.
The other ones that are always, almost always desiccated, even in Montana, with conventional farms, chemical farms I call them, are lentils. And if you look at the lentil harvest behind the combine, it's just a fog of dust of all these tiny little particles of lentil chaff and plant parts. They've now come apart, and now they're floating up into the air, and they'll be coming down as rain because they're so light, they go way up, and it's just tiny dust particles. And that's we think, is also another source of glyphosate going into the clouds, coming back as rain.
So what's your solution? You must have a solution.
Well, of course, organic is the solution.
But because it's in the rain.
Well, but if more people went organic, there'd be less glyphosate.
Yeah, right.
So
yeah.
We're not going to ban it, that's for sure. Yeah. Although there's more and more work being done in questioning its effect, even not only on wheat sensitivity symptoms, but also on cancer and all kinds of other things that they're starting to question. And glyphosate in its current use, and I don't know how many, hundreds of millions of tons, I don't know, but its use has gone up, particularly with GMOs.
Yeah.
And it's used with GMOs for weed control, for GMO-resistant crops now. It's gone up.
How about the BT toxins that they use for corn that they spray as a pesticide? Does that filter into the into the weed or not? Or is this pretty much
I don't know anything about that.
Okay.
We're not in corn country.
Okay.
We haven't seen that as a problem. That's not, BT is not it's a natural occurring substance. So it's not like glyphosate, which is a man-made toxin.
Why is wheat country colder climates? Is it because wheat is a hardier grain, it can withstand the cold, or corn is a
summer grain? No, there's a little of that. Of course, corn needs warmer weather than wheat, but they overlap, and they overlap with, it's more conditioned on water availability. So where we go, we're in Montana, we're 12 to 14 inches of rainfall with no irrigation, no possibility of irrigation. Our groundwater is all contaminated with salt, or has high salt levels in it. So we can never use it for irrigation. Well, if you put it on your lawn 5 or 6 years, your lawn's gonna start to die and in spots.
Yeah.
Although we drank the water growing up. I mean, I couldn't taste it until I started drinking distilled water for several years, and then I could taste the salt.
Wow.
And, the doctors told my wife, we were expecting, I guess, our third, fourth daughter, they said, don't drink that water anymore, there's too much sodium in it. So then that's when we went to distilled water. But my grandparents drank it for over 30 years, killed them both, I guess. My grandpa was 97, my grandma was 93. I figured it was the water. So that's what we tell people.
That killed him?
Yeah.
At 97?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Give me
some of that water.
Yeah, that's right. So, sometimes we worry about maybe sometimes the wrong thing.
Yeah.
But it's there, and but you can't use it for irrigation. That was the main point.
All right, so tell me about your research.
You've
gone on a lot of research on wheat and on KAMUT. Tell me some. You did some stuff on modern grain, modern wheat versus refined wheat versus KAMUT. What did you find?
Well, actually, we started on this about almost 30 years ago, when people started telling us they could eat it and they couldn't eat modern wheat. And the first time this happened, we were astonished. And we gave pasta samples out to this person, and they gave it to to her sister, who couldn't eat lots of foods. And not only could she eat, including wheat, and not only could she eat this wheat, but after a few weeks of eating the KAMUT pasta, she was less allergic to other things. Then we really got interested and looked at the grain in a whole different light. It was no longer a novelty for us. That's when we went to the trademark idea and got a trademark. And then we started trying to find people in America who would help us. And most of the research scientists, now we're talking about almost 30 years ago, they said, there's no difference between your wheat and any other wheat. Wheat's wheat. If people think they're feeling better, it's all in their head. And they were no help to me at all. They just laughed at me. And so that was that was the reception I got. It's a little different now. I mean, 30 years has made a difference. But we ended up trying to look at glycemic index. We looked at just protein, chemical makeup, all kinds of nutritional factors. We found One thing we found was significantly higher was selenium. Selenium was higher than in modern wheat. It's taking it up more in the soil.
More antioxidants.
Yes, and so we knew that, I suppose, that the antioxidant capacity was going to be higher. And I finally found a team in Italy, in the University of Bologna. It's almost 1,000 years old, so it's quite credible.
Right.
And the University of Florence, who was very interested in doing research on this. Because you can imagine in Italy, if you can't eat pasta, this is a very serious thing.
Right.
And this is the days before any wheat-free or gluten-free pasta. I mean, it didn't exist. And in Italy, that doesn't really go much anyway. They are so finicky about their food. It has to be just tough shelf, tough quality. Yeah. So we found this group, and I proposed to them to do this antioxidant test. And so we could afford just a rat study. So it was just a simple rat study. Half the rats ate the modern wheat in the form of food. So we gave them bread, not grain or flour. We gave them bread and pasta and also sourdough bread compared to yeasted bread. And then the other half had the KAMUT products. And they were given the shot of DOX, which is used to be used to cure cancer, or cancer treatment didn't cure it, but it had so many side effects that it was discontinued. One of the side effects is that it created a lot of free radicals. And to measure antioxidants, you want to start with high level free radicals and see how they're decreased.
Right.
And we found that the ancient wheat did decrease the free radicals much more, significantly more than the modern wheat did. And we expected that, but we wanted to get some numbers on it. And so we published two papers on that. And then just by happenstance, it sometimes works in science, somebody noticed and looking at the lymph nodes and pancreas and some other organs, that there wasn't any inflammation in the rats who had eaten the KAMUT grain. And that was very surprising to them because they noticed the other side effect, besides free radicals that this doxis creates, is inflammation.
Right.
And so they looked at the modern wheat and it was there all over. And so here we have a grain that for the first time ever was reported to be anti-inflammatory. That was enormous discovery.
So tell me, when you talk about modern wheat, was it bread that was made like from the grocery store modern wheat, or what was the actual? Because there's so many different kinds of bread. Some has
preservatives
in it and cooked oils in it to keep it soft. And
well, okay, that's a really good question. So what we did in all of our experiments, and we went to human studies, we did the same thing there. We had all the wheat products made as we asked. And they were very simple breads, pastas, crackers, and we gave the human people flour so they could make some stuff at home. And they were instructed not to eat any other wheat other than what we gave them. They didn't know what they were eating. It was either modern or ancient. And we just arbitrarily said anything after World War II is modern, and before that is heritage or heirloom wheat.
So it could it be, to play devil's advocate here, could it be, because I know most of the bread that's modern bread, even if it's organic, it has, if you look at the ingredients on really good bread, it's, you know, organic whole wheat, water, salt, maybe a starter.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at any modern organic wheat, even the best here in Boulder, you have the best organic wheat bread, you know, but it's the ingredients are just, you don't know half the ingredients. They've got cooked oils, and those cooked oils were linked to processed foods, were linked to congestion of your gallbladder and the breakdown of your digestive system.
Yeah.
So I make the contention, for sure, ancient wheat, I'm all on board, but a lot of the inability to digest lots of foods and have such an overwhelming amount of food intolerances is because of the great breakdown of our digestive system due to 60 years of processed foods.
Yep.
And so I'm wondering, when you study modern versus ancient wheat, are we looking at organic? I know some of your studies were organic modern wheat,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
But were they organic processed modern wheat?
Mm-hmm.
The difference, you know?
Yeah.
And that could continue to contribute to that. Because what happens, the research that I found is that when you have broken down digestion, the protein molecules and the fat molecules are too big to get broken down and get into the bloodstream.
Mm-hmm.
And they end up getting taken up by the collecting ducts of your lymphatic system,
mm-hmm.
which makes sense that you saw lymphatic inflammation in your studies due to the modern sort of / refined wheat.
Yes.
And it may be that food, I'm a big believer that food, and there's good science showing that breaks down the digestive system, doesn't let you break it down. Those foods act as irritants to the intestinal skin, create
mm-hmm.
intestinal inflammation, and cause a lot of the symptoms we see as modern wheat, with modern wheat. For ancient wheat, and even if it, and I'm wondering, my question is if you had, you know, sort of modern wheat that was mm-hmm. whole wheat, the whole wheat as a, that wasn't cooked in this refined way with cooked oils and a bunch of preservatives and additives, would that, I don't think it would have the antioxidant potential that your wheat has, but would it be less inflammatory or actually be less harmful as an irritant to the intestinal skin and therefore digestible, or is mm-hmm. it still the processed version of the meat, wheat that we eat? What do you
think?
Well,
that's a really good question. So from our rat study and stumbling on the question of inflammation or anti-inflammatory, we know that all chronic disease is linked to inflammation.
Right.
And so we started immediately then looking at chronic diseases. And the first one we looked at was irritable bowel syndrome.
Right.
And that's a big one.
I saw that study you did.
Yes. And so, again, we're using organically processed stuff,
right.
Both modern and ancient, minimally processed, minimal amount of, yeah. of ingredients. And what we saw in the irritable bowel syndrome, that every single person in our study, and again, it was a double-blind crossover study, both of them, both sides experienced either modern or ancient wheat, so it was a sort of a self-internal control.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't know what they were eating. It was double-blind, so even the professors didn't know what they were eating until everything was done. And every single person had 50 to 100% reduction of their symptoms.
Wow.
You can't even, there's no pill
yeah.
on the market that will do that.
Yeah.
So this is, you know, Hippocrates said 2,300 years ago that food should be our medicine, medicine should be our food. And this is a really prime example of that in action.
Yeah.
This is something, no side effects, and complete better result than any medicine can do.
Yeah.
So I think, but your point is well taken, because if you look at, you can have an organic Twinkie, for heaven's sakes.
Right.
I mean, just because it's organic
doesn't
mean
right.
that it's really completely healthy. Certainly you're eliminating the chemical inputs, and so there is a certain level of improvement, but you can still use over-processed foods or ingredients.
Because after I read your study, and you've got, he's got studies on KAMUT, supporting the benefits of getting preventing type 2 diabetes,
mm-hmm.
irritable bowel syndrome,
mm-hmm.
Inflammation, all these factors.
So cardiovascular.
Cardiovascular. So I did some homework, and I found that I found some studies that just took, you know, refined wheat versus whole wheat,
mm-hmm.
both modern. And I found that that actually protected the intestine and actually reversed the inflammation that's linked to leaky gut syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
So I did find some studies. I am not in any way suggesting that modern wheat is as good as an ancient wheat that KAMUT, because I do believe that lots of things, the more we hybridize anything, the less time we have genetically to figure it out.
Well, we don't know what we're doing. That's
right.
the trouble.
We don't know.
We don't know what we're doing. What we're doing now, after seeing the inflammatory cytokines that we're measuring are up to a third reduced.
Right.
That is enormous difference.
That's huge.
And that was more than any other things that we looked at. It was more than the reduction of cholesterol, which we saw, reduction of blood sugar in the diabetes, we saw reduction of the LDL's cholesterol, the bad cholesterol. All that was kind of bouncing around 8 to 10 to 12% reduction.
Yeah.
The
inflammation was how? What percentage inflammation?
35 to 38. I mean, went 33 to 38, depending on which cytokine we're looking at and which test we're looking at. So now I'm working on another project, working on cell cultures that use human gut cell cultures and trying to establish an inflammatory index so that we can do the very thing you're talking about.
Right.
Because I totally believe in what we've seen in just one test, hasn't been published or proven yet, but in one instance we saw a heritage grain that they were using in Italy just constantly. It was anti-inflammatory, just like the KAMUT brand khorasan was.
Right.
But in one of their tests, it turned out to be inflammatory, and they couldn't figure out why. And then they went back and looked at all their records, and here it is coming from a chemical field. So it was using chemical agriculture, and it had turned that anti-inflammatory grain into inflammatory grain. And so I think that we can move things on this index once we get it established, depending on how we process it. So certainly things like sourdough probably moves it into the anti-inflammatory range.
Right.
Even bad grain moves it closer to that.
Right.
And maybe we could take good grain and use fast-rising yeast or other bad practices of processing and move it closer, or chemical agriculture, and move it out of anti-inflammatory into inflammatory range.
So
this is what we're hoping to be able to find.
Beautiful. This is so important because there's so many variables.
Yes, there are. And that's why it's not just the seed.
Yeah.
It's how you grow it,
right.
and then how you process it.
What you grow it in, how you process
yes.
it. Yeah.
And there's so many different ways of processing.
Who's growing it? A farmer like you with such a great attitude, even epigenetically, there's even science shows that your emotions and how much you love your wheat.
I love my wheat, yes. It's true. I love my farm.
You can tell. So tell me about, I mean, I want some KAMUT bread now.
Okay, well.
Where do we get it? How do people get it?
Well,
how do the people buy, you know, where can they get it?
We have a website, KAMUT.com. You can go on that and see what the products are. And then go to your local health food store and ask. In America, unfortunately, we don't have near as many as they have in especially Italy. 75% of everything we grow goes to Italy because they've just taken it over like it was one of their own. And there's probably 4,500 different products on the market. But in America, we only have a couple hundred of those, less than 100 probably. But the health food stores, you can ask for Bob's Red Mill, for grain and flour. There's couscous and bulgur available now from California. We have many different types of cereal, cold cereals, Nature's Path, the Heritage cereals are mostly all KAMUT brand wheat. Eden Foods makes KAMUT pasta. Several local bakeries make some KAMUT bread. Rudy's is making some here in Colorado with a mixture of ancient wheat, including KAMUT. But there's some great harvest bakeries that are making 100% KAMUT. You just have to ask them.
Right.
And if with enough demand, they'll do it.
Wow, that's good. Now you have to help them get rid of the vegetable oils that keep the bread, you know, on the shelf longer and keep it squishy longer. Because there's really good science to suggest that that directly breaks down our digestive system, increases the risk of metabolic syndrome, which is high blood sugar, high blood pressure, belly fat, high cholesterol, low good cholesterol, by a whopping 141%. When people ate whole foods, including whole wheat, they reduced that by 38%. So that's the other piece of the puzzle, is to fight for not just the right kind of grain, but the stuff we do to it, like you said, to make it stay on the shelf longer, stay squishy, and give people what they want, squishy bread.
We got to
get over that.
Yeah, we grow high oleic safflower on our farm, and I know we need to talk about that, because I don't know what you're found in your research on that, but the high oleic, and that's not all safflower is high oleic either. You have to have high oleic, so it has to be 85 or more percent
of
oleic.
So tell me how you process it. How does that work?
We just cold press it. So there's no processing.
What's
so
the heat? How hot does it get?
100 degrees.
That's it?
Yep.
Yeah.
And that's on the that's in a warm day. And in the cold of winter, we don't heat our sheds, but where it's processed, but it's all cold press. And it comes out, and then we filter it through cloth and paper.
Right.
So all the antioxidants in there, the vitamins that are in the oil, remain in the oil.
So how does it stay from going rancid? Oils are so delicate to going rancid.
Not if they're high oleic. High oleic, it's a monounsaturated fat, a fatty acid, oleic acid is. And so it's very extremely stable.
So high oleic safflower is sort of more like olive oil, which is...
Yeah, it's better than olive oil.
Really?
Yeah. It has high...
Tell us why.
Well, it's more stable.
Really?
And olive oil, if you look on the container, it says for medium heat cooking.
Right.
But for safflower oil, it's the best for high temperature cooking because it's so stable.
What's the flash point on that?
Oh, boy.
It's pretty high?
It's pretty high. And then that's another indication in the smoke point that it's so stable.
Yeah.
And we have found that our customers... we supply all the oil from Montana State University and the University of Montana now in Bozeman and Missoula, and they use it in all their kitchens. And even though it came into them at a much higher price than their cheap oil, in the end, it lasted so much longer before they had to discard it, and they can smell it and taste it when it starts to go bad, so they know when to switch it out.
Right.
And ours lasted so much longer that they actually turned out to be cheaper oil for them.
Really?
So that's really important. It's just like the gluten you were talking about earlier.
Right.
As there are all kinds of gluten, there's all kinds of oils.
So when you go to the grocery store, there's a whole aisle of oils in clear plastic bottles.
Yeah.
And bleach, deodorizer, refined oil.
Don't buy that.
What is that?
Well, that's refined food again.
Right.
And it's an industrialized result of an industrialized model of cheap food production.
Don't most bread makers use
probably
bulk? Because they're not going to buy the super expensive ones to put in their bread, right? Because
But the really good ones will.
Right.
I mean, ask
right.
them, ask them.
And you got to find those really good.
And ask them the question, you know, what kind of oil do you use?
Yeah.
I mean, are you using the cheap, El Cheapo stuff?
Right.
Cheap as you can get, or which is not good for you for sure.
Right.
And are you using stuffing that's more high quality and that we know it is good for you? Because the body, we need a certain amount of fat.
So you need to promote, I don't tell you what you need to do, you know what you're doing, but I just feel like the people need to know we need to have a way to, for people to really understand. If you can say like expeller pressed organic safflower oil, and it could be junk.
Yeah, it could be, because you could also be using high linoleic safflower, which isn't so good for you, for example. So you really have to understand and know what the food quality is, and there's a big, big difference. And what we need to do in this country, I believe, is start to drive things into high nutrition instead of high productivity or cheap, which turns into cheap food. I mean, we should be looking at high quality instead of low price, because in the end, that low price comes back and it's very expensive for you. Yeah. But people need to think of it in terms of long term. I wouldn't put the cheapest oil in my best car, and yet we want to put the cheapest food in the most magnificent machine that's ever been created. This is it's nonsensical.
Doesn't make any sense.
No, but it's short term.
Yeah,
and it's just a way of thinking. We think we can't cut corners on our rent. We can't cut corners on electricity, or, you know, all these things that we need. But food seems to be something that people think they can cut corners on, but it's not really true.
Isn't it more challenging and expensive for a farmer or a you know, a mill to mill the grain and separate, you know, the endosperm from the, you know, and separate, you know, the oil and the germ? Isn't that, it seems like a very elaborate process. How does that happen? And why wouldn't you just grind it up the seed in your hat?
Well, originally what they wanted was long shelf life, and they wanted to be able to ship it, you know, all over the country, all over the world. So you take out the germ and the brand. The brand's not causing it to deteriorate, but the germ is.
Yeah.
The oils and the germ will oxidize.
Right.
And they will
shorten it. Is that natural to get? I mean, isn't it, seems like a very elaborate, I mean, I just, how do they get the germ out of the?
Well, that's what industrialized process. They've got that all figured out. So it's done very, very cheaply on a huge, huge volume. And very, very quickly.
Some of the grain in his hat is like hard as rock. The concept, the idea that they could actually open that up and take the oil out of that, just the thought of that tells me that this is such a highly, forget about just getting the oil out, getting to the oil has to be such a highly processed thing.
They have that all figured out. They soak the grain, they temp, what they call temperate, so they bring up the moisture, and then they put it in their big giant roller mills that reduce the size more and more and more. And one of the first things, the first crack, it pops the germ out as a unit.
Really?
The germ is separated quite easily.
Oh, really?
Actually, the bran has been more difficult to separate. Now, this is interesting that I found, and I'm not sure how many people it affects, but one of the things that they've done, I mentioned earlier, to the bran is make it harder, so it's easier to flake off and leave more white endosperm to make more white flour.
Right.
Well, now that bran is so hard that if you grind that up and add it back to make whole wheat flour, it's like grinding up glass almost, because it's so hard. I mean, that's a little bit over the top, but it's the idea that it's not soft anymore. So when it goes into your, when you eat it, it can be an irritant to your bowels.
Right.
And so people who are sensitive can be irritated by whole grain, when it should be a healing thing to them. But they've changed the brand. Now it's not soft anymore to kind of be a, like scrubbers for your inside of your intestines. Now it's more like little knives going through irritating it. That can happen to some people depending on their level.
How often does it take in whole wheat? Do they actually take the bran off, the endosperm, the germ, separate them out, get rid of the germ, and then bring the bran and the starch back? Because that's what you're saying. To make whole wheat, you take it, separate it out, and put it back together.
Yeah, and they're supposed to put even the germ back. I mean, that's supposed to be done, but it's not always done by the by the big commercial people.
Call it whole wheat.
Yes, and there's certain rules and regulations that allow them to be somewhat less than 100% of the original package and still call it whole wheat.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. But if you're doing stone ground, for example, then it's all together. You can't separate that.
So how often is whole wheat, you know, the grain is actually broken up and then put back together? Is that all the time or only?
It's all the time with the big industrial plants.
Right.
But with stone mills, with micronizing mills that are cutting the grain into tiny, with hammered mill type, that they're crushing it. They're just using the whole grain. It's, everything going in is coming out.
So it's really mixed. Back to the small farmer, back to the small mills, and getting away from the big industrialized bread.
Well,
because whole wheat bread in the grocery store sort of looks like, I mean, that's been around forever, and that doesn't solve anybody's problems.
Well, that's the way it's done. They could do it right.
Yeah.
They could do it right.
Amazing. Amazing. Yeah.
So far we published 18 peer-reviewed journal articles on this subject.
Yeah.
Just the last five or six or so have been on human clinical trials, which are the most exciting and the most interesting to us.
Yeah.
And now we're looking at non-alcoholic fatty liver syndrome. We are finding in our tests for diabetes, we did blood analysis looking at messenger RNA because we wanted to see if we could see what was happening at the cellular level, the gene level. We don't really understand the mode of action of this yet. We really don't.
Mm-hmm.
But we are finding that even the genes that control inflammation are being stimulated by modern wheat. A diet of modern wheat stimulates those genes. It means that they're acting at higher velocity, making more messenger RNA. That's what we're measuring.
Mm-hmm.
And the ancient wheat was actually depressing their activity. So mm-hmm. it's actually acting at the cellular level
right.
in some of these aspects. Not all of them, probably, but at least that we were able to demonstrate that. And that paper will be published here in the next few months.
Wow.
So that's really exciting for us.
Yeah. No, you're doing such good work. And your farm now, how much KAMUT are you actually producing a year now?
All together? You mean the whole project?
Yeah.
Well, this year we hope to plant 120,000 acres.
Wow, that's beautiful.
Over, and probably using, contracting with about 100 or 250 organic farmers.
In Montana, the popularity of just organic farming versus conventional farming, how's that going?
Oh man, it's still, we're in our infancy.
Really?
So Montana, we may be approaching, we're over 1%. We may be getting close to 2%, but nationwide, it's only 1% of the farmers are organic. The demand is nearly 5% in the grocery store now. So, and yet USDA research, for example, is less than 1%. It's a fraction of 1% toward organic. I mean, this is, so the more, most of the research.
So who's holding this up?
Well, guess who's holding it up? The people in charge, the people who have something to lose if you change the system. And the system is industrialized chemical agriculture. That's the system. So I'm going to, probably don't want to get political here, but I'm going to write to President Trump and say, okay, you claim, and all your speeches talked about change and drain the swamp and giving people a chance for jobs and prosperity in this country. Let me tell you about conventional industrialized chemical agriculture. My neighbors cannot pay their chemical bills. They're going to go broke. They're going to lose their farm, some of them. This is a tragedy. They're going to lose, the jobs will go away. The small towns that they support are going to lose more jobs. It's all diminishing. And it's all based on the chemical industrial model.
Because you're addicted to having to buy those chemicals.
They don't know any other way.
Right.
And if we could at least, one of the things, the government doesn't have to come out and ban all the chemicals right away. I mean, that would be chaos.
Right.
But they could increase the research money to help those farmers that do want to change know how to do it more successfully.
How to transition.
Most farmers don't want to change because they don't know where to start.
Right.
I've gotten more calls for people to help, for me to help them change
in
the last 6 months than I've had in the last 30 years. So that's starting to change, but still there's no, the colleges are all geared to the chemical industrial complex. There's very few that are doing organic research, just very few. And if you turn back the clock 120 years, say, and you looked at if the government was doing such a thing, they weren't doing it then, supporting research. Imagine that they were supporting the creation or an improvement of stagecoaches so that they'd be safer, more comfortable after the automobile had already been invented. Wouldn't there be an outcry against something like that?
Yeah.
It's the same kind of mentality we have now. People ask me, does organic have a future? I tell them, organic, it's not that they have a future or not. It is the future. So I say that they can feed the world. We know in third world countries, if they change to organic, they increase their yields two to three times. That would take the pressure off of feeding the world. The chemical model can't do that. And who's going to pay for the chemicals in Asia, in Africa? They have no money to do that. But yet most of those people in third world countries that are feeding 3/4 of the world's population are doing it on small farms and small plots. And if they just added soil building and rotations, principles of organic agriculture to their peasant farms, that they can increase their yields by double or three times.
Incredible.
So that's the message.
Yeah.
In America, we don't see an increase over the chemical model, but we don't see very much of a decrease either. So the myth is that we're going to all be starving if we go to organic. That is just bunk.
So we should all be writing to our congressmen and women and telling them we demand organic foods and support, and tell this government that we really need to let them know that we support farmers transitioning back to the way it was.
Because and give them some help. Give them some help to figure out the problems, because there are problems. There's weed problems. There's better ways of soil building that we could learn about. Yeah. If we spend a fraction of the money that we spend on chemical agriculture, on organic agriculture, we would have these problems figured out. And the yields would go up and it would become more stable. Everybody wins. This is the blessing with organic. In small town America, the money doesn't go out a state to some big multinational chemical company. It stays locally because we're growing our own fertilizer and we're growing our own food and fuel in some cases. We're bringing back the oil that we sell to University of Montana, Montana State University. We clean it, we filter it, and we put it in our tractor. We don't make biodiesel. We're making straight vegetable oil in our tractor, and it runs just fine. So we're using it first for food, second for fuel, and we eliminate the whole debate on the food versus fuel use of our farm ground.
Wow, incredible. There's a study that you should go tell all your non-organic conventional farmers. They did a study with farmers breathing pesticide dust in their mouth, and it literally eradicated whole strains of microbes in the mouth that support immunity, the ability to digest anything hard to digest, like the wheat that they're actually growing. You know,
and imagine what it's doing your soil.
Yeah,
it's actually spraying it right on your soil. I mean, it's really hard on the microbiology of the soils. The organic principle is that we feed the soil, and the soil feeds the plant.
Yeah.
So the chemical model is that you feed the plant, and you don't pay any attention. They don't care what goes on in the soil. The soil is an anchor. Yeah. You know, it collects rain. I mean, that's the idea. But if the plant needs some food, we'll feed it, and I'll sell you the stuff in a bag, and you can feed your plants. But the organic model is that we feed the soil, and the soil then becomes more viable, and that soil feeds the plant and keeps the plant healthier.
Yeah.
So there's less need for chemicals and fighting diseases and other things because the plants are healthier.
Yeah, of course.
And the chemical model, it's just the opposite. The plants are under more stress, they're growing faster, they're more susceptible to disease. So you have to spray more chemicals to kill the disease. With all the fertilizer you put on, that's also stimulating weeds, so you have to put on more chemicals to kill the weeds. Now you have resistant weeds. Now you have to put more chemicals on to kill the resistant weeds. It's just a vicious cycle.
Yeah.
And the organic is not a vicious cycle. It puts you into sustainability and a case that can go on for eons, and everybody wins.
Yeah. I think people in our community, and maybe people who listen to us, they're so naturally minded, organic minded. I think this is sort of a shock to hear how resistant, you know, our government is and farmers are and the whole industry is to actually growing organic. You know, we always think that, hey, organic's coming back and it's a new thing, everything's gonna take, and it's really just—
It's very small, it's still very small.
Yeah, it's just amazing. Is there anything else you wanna share with us before we wrap up here today?
Oh, well, I just really appreciate you inviting me, John, and letting us share some of the things we've been doing.
Yeah.
If people have questions, they can find a lot of our research on our website, as I mentioned, KAMUT.com.
KAMUT.com.
Yep. And we're continuing that. We think that it's not just KAMUT, but other organic or other ancient grains like emmer and spelt and heritage wheat that were pre-World War II, many of those have similar attributes.
Right.
We're just focusing on this one because it happened to where we landed.
You got King Tut's grain.
So
you can't go anywhere else once you have that, right?
Yeah. You know, the King Tut story, I should tell you, I don't know if we have enough, how many minutes we got?
We're good.
Okay, anyway, I went to Cairo and I looked in the museum because I really wanted to know, is this really out of the tomb? Because people would ask me, I said, well, that's what we were told. And I looked in the museum and some of the grain that came out of the tombs, and it wasn't that at all. It was like einkorn. I thought, oh man, that's a downer. Yeah, einkorn has little striations on it and it has this particular shape you can recognize. Yeah. And I recognize it because I know what I've grown it too. I know what it looks like. And none of it, our grain is very large with a kind of a hump shape and big on one end, small on the other end. So it's very easy to spot.
Yeah.
It wasn't there. So I was really, deflated. But when I went to Turkey, we were doing experiments in Turkey to see if we could grow it closer to our markets, which we experimented all over the world. We came back to the northern Great Plains, the best place to grow this. But anyway, in Turkey, they said, oh, well, we know this grain. We still grow this in small patches. It's not commercially available, but farmers markets, you can find it. We call it camel's tooth because of the way it's shaped.
Camel's tooth, and it's hard as rock.
It is. So it's like a good tooth. Right. Or they call it the prophet's sweet. I said, oh, that's really interesting. Why do you call it the prophet's wheat? I said,
the prophet's sweet.
The prophet's wheat.
The prophet's wheat, okay, good.
So the wheat of the prophet.
The prophet's wheat. Oh, I like that.
And I said, why did you call it the prophet's wheat? I said, it has something to do with Muhammad because they're pretty Muslim there, and that's what I thought they might be referring to. I said, oh, no. I said, not that prophet. They said, you know, the one with the boat. And I said, the boat? I said, you mean Noah? Oh, yes. This is the grain Noah brought with him on the ark. And I said, wow, that's a lot better story than an old tomb story. So anyway, I went to Armenia, and they have the same legend there.
Really?
This grain came, because they, Mount Ararat, you know, borders the two countries, and Armenians have the same legend. So, you know, the good book says, in the mouth of two or three witnesses shall all things be established. I said, that's good enough for me. So that's what we tell now instead of our tomb story, because I couldn't verify that.
Are you going to change the name, the Noah's Wheat?
No, well, we're looking, see if they find the ark first. And then, and maybe if we can find a little kernel in there. I know, but you know. It's just fun,
yeah.
But it's really interesting how the different paths have led us to different even legends and different ways of looking at this. And now the research, I think, if we can have a cell culture test, which we can do for around $100, if we could put that in the hands of every wheat breeder in the world so that they could test not only for yields and all the things they normally do, but also for high nutrition and inflammatory properties.
Antioxidants, yeah.
Yeah, and antioxidants are all tied together with inflammation too.
Yeah.
And if they could kick out the grain that it's causing inflammation and focus on the stuff that's anti-inflammatory, we could change the diet or the wheat available throughout the world, and imagine what that would do to health.
I mean, that's what a lot of researchers are doing, always trying to find that one strain that maybe has less inflammation. I read a lot of studies about that, and they're looking for that magic strain, but I don't know why they don't just settle on something that we've had around for...
It's not magic, it's already there.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Why don't we just start trying to reinvent and hybridize a new strain?
Yep.
Why don't we go back to what was actually originally there?
Yep.
Makes good sense, right?
It does. I've been working with about 100 different new strains of, well, they're not new, they're wild wheat from Turkey, but they're winter wheat strains. The KAMUT khorasan is a spring wheat. So I was looking at some winter wheats to see if we can find some good winter wheats also. And some of them have almost as good as yield as some of our modern ones.
Wheat and spring wheat really came out? Because the original wheat, you know, way, way back when, thousands of years ago, because I've got studies in my books to show that wheat was eaten 3.5 million years ago in the grasslands. They found gluten in the teeth of ancient humans 3.5 million years ago, and it was harvested in the fall for winter eating. And it was it. Didn't harvest again in the spring. It was a fall harvested grain. Amylase is an enzyme that helps us digest it. That increases in our bodies in the fall for the winter eating, suggesting that we are adapted evolutionarily to be able to eat wheat in season in the fall. Mm-hmm. So when did this spring, you know, winter thing happen?
Well, that's a little misnomer that they're talking about seeding time, not harvest time.
Okay.
So the spring wheat in the northern climates where we are, the wheat that cannot stand the winter, that's not winter hardy, is only planted in the spring. It's also harvested in the fall.
I see.
But the winter wheat that's winter hardy, you could take some of those spring wheats, and if you go to Texas or the Mediterranean with them, like the KAMUT, you can plant that in the fall and it'll go through the winter, but they don't have a winter like we know.
Right.
And so then become winter wheat. So it's a little bit of a...
I see, where you are.
Yeah.
So
different wheats grow differently and have different characteristics. So it's not as simple as...
What's the hardiest?
The hardiest?
The one that will actually last the coldest winters.
Oh, well, that again is something that they've bred and selected.
Okay.
But if you go back at wild wheats and just, you can do your own selection. Ancient man did that.
They
made natural selections. Yeah. And another important point is that all those selections were land races, which means that they weren't a pure strain like what we're trying to do now with our breeding program.
Right.
We try to get a pure strain, like you said earlier, the magic bullet that everybody looked for. No such thing. If you have a land race with many different strains, they have many different characteristics. So if something comes in that a cold snap and some of its types are less hardy or more hardy, it'll kill out some, but others survive.
Right.
Disease is the same thing.
Right.
And they're not all susceptible to the same disease. So it adds a huge amount of stability to the wheat crop.
Yeah.
And when you have a single strain, then you have something that's of high risk.
And those are all considered ancient wheats, right?
Well, originally they all were.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they still exist around in seed banks.
Right.
They've been gathered in there.
So what you're saying is that the original hybridization, the selection thousands of years ago, actually created a level of diversity that probably had something to do with the wheat lasting so long because it was more resistant, right?
Well, and also it gives diversity to your nutrition.
Right.
That you eat.
Yeah.
And that's important.
Yeah.
So
fascinating. We could talk forever.
Rest of the day.
I'd love to get into the actual details about you know wheat and maybe we'll have you come back.
Well, that would be great. We don't need to tell the whole story in 1 hour.
Yeah, right. Can't do that.
It's my pleasure.
Yeah,
John.
Really,
thank you for inviting me.
An honor to have you here. Yeah. Really, thank you so much. And please go to his website at kamut.com. Right?
Yep. Very simple. KAMUT.com.
Yeah. Go there and see where.
Look under health, and then the second button will be research. And that's where you can find all our research stuff.
Yeah, and then to find, you know, some of recipes the products. Some
also.
Of the products.
Recipes and where to find it in your area.
Yeah.
At least the stores or the types of products available.
Yeah.
Where your grain
is actually being, you know, utilized.
Yeah, you can find it.
Great. Cool. Wonderful. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, did you like this video? Do you like our content here at LifeSpa? You can subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/JohnDouillard right here and get this valuable content every week in your inbox.
This recording is brought to you by LifeSpa, where ancient Ayurvedic wisdom meets modern science. Get access to free health video newsletters by Dr. John at lifespa.com. These statements have not been evaluated by the FDA. These products are not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease.